A portion of this video is sponsored by Policy Genius. After the Concord was retired in 2003 because of economic and environmental issues, supersonic passenger jets vanished from our skies. Yet nearly two decades later, they might be making a return. A startup has promised an affordable supersonic jet, which runs on a net zero carbon fuel. Is this going to be a profitable and eco-friendly boom, or just a noisy bust? There's a pretty clear path towards cleaner transportation when it comes to cars and trucks, but larger scale transportation like flight is a harder nut to crack. That's why I've looked at things like electric flight and biofuels in other videos. We also tend to be impatient, especially in this fast-paced global economy. Having breakfast in New York, lunching in London, and enjoying dinner back in the Big Apple sounds like an impossible schedule, and an exhausting one. But that was possible nearly 50 years ago when the Concorde was originally launched. Jointly developed by British Airways and Air France, the world's first commercial passenger supersonic jet cruised at Mach 2, meaning traveling twice as fast as sound. Thanks to this sound-breaking speed, people could fly from New York to London in just under 3 hours. So why are we taking twice as long to fly the same distance today? And one of the things grounding the Concorde was the so-called sonic boom. This is the bang made by a plane that breaks the speed of sound at 700 miles per hour. However, the speed of sound isn't the only thing getting broken by the Concorde. After the Air Force ran a test over Oklahoma City in the 1960s, residents reported hundreds of cracked windows. As a result of issues like that, the Federal Aviation Administration deemed the US territory a no supersonic flying zone. Aside from noise disturbances, environmental concerns also contributed to the negative sentiment towards the Concorde. In fact, the supersonic jet was also super polluting. Compared to a subsonic plane, it generated pollutants at 5 times the rate. On top of that, the nitrogen oxide emissions were puncturing another important barrier, the ozone layer. Nevertheless, the Concorde was officially grounded for good because of unfavorable economics. The deadly plane crash in 2000, along with the 9/11 attacks the year after, dramatically dropped the passenger demand for flying. As a result, British Airways and Air France could no longer sustain fuel and other operating costs. If you'd like to learn more about the Concorde, you should check out some of the fantastic videos on the YouTube channel Real Engineering. I'll include a link in the description. There might be another chance of traveling supersonically in the future. Last January, Boom Supersonic unveiled their plan of building a massive factory in Piedmont Triad International Airport in North Carolina. This new plant would be used for producing their Overture supersonic jet. This 80-seat Concorde 2.0 isn't scheduled to test fly until 2026 at a top speed of Mach 1.7, which is about twice as fast as a Boeing 747. However, you won't be able to jump onto the plane yourself until testing is complete in 2029. In the meantime, Boom has been closing deals with different airlines. Japan Airlines was the first one betting on the supersonic technology, securing 20 aircrafts in 2017. Domestically, United Airlines broke the sound of silence by ordering 15 supersonic jets in 2021. The most recent airline to jump on the supersonic bandwagon was American Airlines, who already paid a non-refundable deposit for securing 20 of Boom's jets. Now, all these deals give airlines the option of buying more planes later on. Yet all these agreements are valid as long as Boom's supersonic flights meet safety, operating, and sustainability requirements. So how is the Colorado-based startup doing with that? Because of the Concorde's eventual failure, many believe supersonic jets will never take off again. So let's run through some of the company's claims, and then we'll get to some of the analysis. First is how Boom is flying high on safety. As claimed by the startup, their supersonic aircraft is mostly based on already proven subsonic technologies, in some cases exceeds current FAA safety standards. Some smart design adjustments help them boost their confidence. For example, instead of aluminum, which was the major component of the Concorde's structure, they're relying on a carbon composite, which is more thermally stable under supersonic conditions. Not to mention it's much lighter, which saves on fuel and leads me to the next point. Apart from trying to deliver a safer journey to passengers, the startup is aiming to make their flights affordable. As touted by their CEO, an Overture ticket will be 4 times cheaper than a Concorde ticket. However, his long-term dream is to charge $100 for a 4-hour flight, which is very ambitious to say the least. To achieve that target, the startup wants to hit a budget of $200 million per plane. And to give you some perspective, the newest Boeing 747 model costs $386.8 million. But how will the Spirit Airlines of supersonic flights keep their costs so low and clean? Well, before getting to that, I'd like to thank Policy Genius for sponsoring this portion of today's video. I always used to have life insurance through my previous jobs, but now I'm running my own business and don't have those policies anymore. And sometimes work policies aren't very good anyway. It's a good idea to take steps to protect your family in case something unplanned happens to give them a financial cushion. Policy Genius makes it crazy easy to find and compare insurance coverage that's right for you. And Policy Genius was built to modernize the life insurance industry and makes it easy to compare quotes from top companies like AIG and Prudential. With Policy Genius, you can find life insurance policies that start at just $17 per month for $500,000 of coverage. And the licensed agents at Policy Genius work for you, not the insurance companies, so you can trust their guidance. They aren't incentivized to recommend one insurer over another, and they can help you find the right options in as little as a week. Just click the link in the description or head over to policygenius.com/undecidedwithmatt to get your personalized quotes and find the right policy for you. Thanks to Policy Genius and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to how Boom is aiming to keep their costs so low. Well, once again, they're leaning in on a more cost-effective aircraft architecture. For instance, the Overture's contoured fuselage and gull wings reduce drag, which requires less engine thrust and fuel. Its four turbofan engines work without relying on fuel-inefficient burners. And speaking of which, Boom is aiming to have their planes running on up to 100% sustainable aviation fuel, which is known as SAF, which could emit up to 80% fewer carbon emissions than kerosene. But more on that later. That's a massive improvement over the kerosene-guzzling Concord. Typically, SAFs are made from greener feedstock, like fast-growing algae or leftover cooking oil. As for Overture, Boom will be tapping into CO2-to-fuel technology from the company Prometheus. And there's a lot to unpack here when it comes to these SAFs. Prometheus's direct air capture system grabs CO2 from the air and upcycles it into net zero SAF, which Prometheus claims will be as cheap as fossil fuels. But again, more on that claim later. They're hoping to have 500 DAC plants up and running by 2030. Each of their facilities is expected to convert 900 tons of CO2 into 100,000 gallons of green fuels every year. So what's their trick? It's called aqueous CO2 electrolysis. First, you mix the captured carbon dioxide with a saline solution. Then you hit the blend with renewable electricity to trigger electrochemical reactions that yield complex alcohols. And these are digested into simpler molecules like ethanol thanks to a catalyst made of carbon and copper. Now, after that, a selective carbon nanotube-based membrane separates ethanol from water. Basically, ethanol's carbon atoms are held back by the inner part of the tubes, while water flows away more easily. Now, this technique is supposed to require 90% less energy than the conventional distillation process, as it doesn't require any water to be vaporized. Now, finally, catalysts will help convert the purified ethanol into jet fuel. Unlike similar solutions, the Prometheus process is supposed to work at atmospheric pressure and room temperature. In theory, this should bring down their capital costs, which I'll get to in a bit. Now, other than investing in Prometheus technology, Boom is also consulting with multiple organizations to scale up SAF adoption. This helps to fuel the transition towards net zero carbon operations, which Boom hopes to achieve by 2025. However, Boom is not the only player in the supersonic game. Virgin Galactic is working on an even faster plane, expecting to hit Mach 3, which nearly doubles Overture's max speed. In practical terms, this means going from New York to London in about 2 hours rather than 3.5 hours. After successfully completing a mission concept review in 2020 with the help of NASA experts, Virgin partnered with Rolls-Royce to develop the engine propulsion technology. Now, while Virgin is breaking Boom's speed limit, a partnership between NASA and Lockheed is making a noise about a less noisy supersonic plane. Their X-59 jet will produce a sonic thump rather than a sonic boom. So think of a basketball bounce rather than fireworks. While it still breaks the sound barrier, the X-59 is designed to be quieter than Overture. Its longer, pointy nose and sharper wings will equally spread the sound waves along the length of the aircraft. The sleeker airframe will prevent individual sound waves from adding up, which muffles the boom. This will also reduce the impulse force felt by the airframe. And thanks to the improved aerodynamics concocted by Lockheed, the X-59 will generate a 75 perceived level decibel noise on the ground. Just to give you a sense of scale, the Concorde's sonic boom was 105 decibels. However, the lower noise pollution will come at an expense of range and passenger capacity. Two things that Boom didn't want to sacrifice. The quieter X-59 aircraft is currently being tested on the ground and is meant to take off later in 2022. So as you can see, there are a lot of promising technologies and companies claiming that they could land us faster, quieter, lower price, and greener supersonic flights. However, sound is not the only barrier that supersonic planes will have to break. All the aircrafts we've talked about haven't even touched the runway, and it will take time to test them to meet all the necessary regulations before passengers can even step on board. After 2 years of collaboration, Boom has decided to part ways with Rolls-Royce and is now on the lookout for a new engine developer, which will most likely cause delays in their timetable. For a point of comparison, about 20 years went by between the Concorde engine's first test and the aircraft's first flight. Also, an aerospace analyst criticized Boom's plan of increasing the number of engines from 3 to 4, warning them against poor economics and higher emissions. SAFs are not quite ready either. As of today, they make up less than 0.1% of the overall aviation fuel and cost up to 8 times more than regular jet fuel. Besides a limited supply, safety regulations compel airlines to use no more than 50% SAF in their blend. Now, according to experts, this conservative threshold gives aircraft manufacturers enough confidence in using this new type of fuel, though this ratio may increase as confidence builds. The International Air Transportation Association predicts a 50-fold increase in the production of SAFs by 2025. And to accelerate SAF rollout in America, last year the U.S. government launched a Sustainable Aviation Fuel Grand Challenge. As part of this initiative, the Biden administration aims to produce a sufficient amount of SAFs to meet 100% of national aviation demand by 2050. Yet a recent report from the Center for Biological Diversity flagged this challenge to be grander than expected. Basically, our current biofuel availability is the limiting factor. According to the report, we could only quench 38% of our thirst for SAFs in the best-case scenario. The authors also questioned the climate mitigation potential of most SAFs, arguing that relying on those alone won't get us to net zero aviation. Instead, they recommended the government improve aircraft fuel efficiency and push the shift towards 100% electric flights. That's easier said than done, though. I covered this in a previous video, but battery energy density is the limiting factor for electric planes. To be more specific, current batteries don't carry enough electricity per unit of weight, which means long-haul electric aircrafts with current technology would be too heavy to fly. But when are SAFs not climate-friendly? Well, it depends on the feedstock that they're made from. For instance, the International Council for Clean Transportation is not cheering for crops like soybeans. Apart from competing with food production, farming them to fuel supersonic planes would promote deforestation. Another thing to consider is how much CO2 soybean plantations will absorb while growing. When performing a life cycle assessment, the UN found that US soy-based SAF would save only 27% carbon emissions compared to Jet A, which is also known as kerosene. The alternative implemented from Enviva is not that much more cheerful for the environment. The world's largest wood pellet producer is essentially cutting trees and giving them to a company to make biofuels for flights. I don't know about you, but this doesn't sound sustainable to me. When you burn that fuel, you release the carbon originally stored in the wood. Although Enviva claims they would replant whatever they cut, some argue that the trees won't grow back fast enough to compensate for those emissions. In other words, the fuel's net zero claims are kind of up in the air. So how about Boom's SAF? Well, capturing CO2 from the air without touching a single tree to make fuel that's priced as much as standard gasoline, it sounds much better, but maybe too good to be true. And for some academics, it's just that. Their skepticism comes from Prometheus not having demonstrated a fully working system or subjecting it to peer review process yet. Plus, their CEO's ambitious but unmet promises are not helping to build trust. Apparently, the startup has promised to sell their greener gasoline at $3 a gallon in 2020, yet they're not even close to that today. But even when using the most sustainable fuel, we would have a supersonic efficiency issue. According to the ICCT, supersonic flights would burn up to 9 times more fuel per passenger per kilometer than their subsonic flying buddies. Aside from implying a higher environmental impact, this would also compromise their economics. And that ties back to the questionable $100 a ticket that Boom hopes to achieve. Cleaner fuels and more efficient aircraft design might bring supersonic flights back to the future, yet the Concord debacle is still too vivid in our minds, and there are many technical challenges ahead to be addressed. Perhaps it's better for us all to work on our patience and be happy traveling just a little bit slower. But it's worth keeping an eye on Boom and seeing how some of these technologies will clean up aviation. There are aspects of engineering, materials, and more efficient engines that could make an impact on subsonic planes. And while I'm hopeful, I think it's a pretty steep hill that they have to climb. So are you undecided? Do you think supersonic flight and cleaner fuels are the answer for next generation planes? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the videos over here. And thanks to all my patrons for your continued support. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.